show tonight, Donald Trump's new running mate and the dump Trump movement gets trumped. But first, the world is stunned and grieving again after a night of horrific violence in the French city of Nice and on a day in which there are reports of a military coup underway in Turkey. Last night in France, a fireworks display had just ended when at least 84 people were killed and more than 200 were injured by a truck that plowed into a crowd celebrating Bastille Day. The attacker was identified as a 31-year-old delivery truck driver from Tunisia. No terrorist groups have claimed responsibility for the attack, which marks the third such tragedy France has seen in just about a year and a half. Today, President Obama gave a somber statement about the attack from the diplomatic corps reception at the White House, where he spoke about efforts to combat terrorism around the world.
We are going to keep taking out ISIL leaders and pushing ISIL back in Syria and Iraq. We're going to keep standing with our partners from Africa to Afghanistan, and we are going to destroy this vile terrorist organization. And in contrast to these terrorists who only know how to kill and destroy, we're going to win this fight by building, by never giving up on diplomacy to end the Syrian civil war, by working with partners around the world, including Muslim communities, to push back against hateful ideologies that twist and distort Islam, a religion that teaches peace and justice and compassion.
President Obama also had some things to say that relate to the political debate here at home.
In the wake of last night's attacks, we've heard more suggestions that all Muslims in America be targeted, tested for their beliefs, some deported or jailed. And the very suggestion is repugnant and an affront to everything that we stand for as Americans. We cannot give in to fear or turn on each other or sacrifice our way of life. We cannot let ourselves be divided by religion, because that's exactly what the terrorists want.
Within hours of the Nice attack, as details were still unfolding in southern France last night, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump both weighed in on this latest horrific attack. Once again, on display were opposing messages about national security, diplomacy, and the global war on terror.
We're not going to have a world anymore. This is crazy what's going on.
It's a different kind of war. We need to be smart about how we wage it, but we have to be determined that we're going to win it.
What are we doing? We're trying to be so nice. We're trying to be so civil. We're so weak.
One of my priorities is to launch an intelligence surge. We still do not have enough intelligence cooperation between our agencies and those in other countries.
We can't let people from terrorist states and all of these people pour into our country, because, you know, it only takes one or two people to create havoc.
We need strong, tough diplomacy, starting with our friends.
I am indeed the law and order candidate, and Hillary is weak and ineffective. She created ISIS with her stupid policies.
So, John, a lot of responding for something that they'll both be asked about again going forward. But what do their responses tell us about what the national security and terror debate is going to be like going forward and as soon as the conventions?
Right. Not much new, I think. You know, those two responses last night were pretty much two nominees playing to type. Hillary Clinton trying to be mature, responsible, reasonable, former Secretary of State trying to adopt that posture, Donald Trump being Donald Trump. That was pretty much the kind of thing you would expect Trump to say, only with this new thematic of the law and order president thrown in, or nominee thrown in. But that basic reaction, which is, we're at war, I'm the tough guy, is pretty much the way Trump has played all these incidents going forward. I didn't see much change from the way they have previously dealt with these matters.
I didn't, although I suspect if there continue to be attacks and if Trump continues to say things like, we need a declaration of war, that she will feel pressure to be more hawkish.
Well, has anybody noted to Trump that President Obama has been seeking an authorization of force from the Republican Congress now for, I believe, at least 6 months, possibly longer, and the Republican Congress, Republican-controlled Congress, wants no part of giving a declaration of war to President Obama? Presumably they would be no more interested in giving one to President Trump, or maybe not.
Well, they might not, but although President Obama has pretty much dropped the topic. Now, you could argue he dropped it because he couldn't get it through, but he has dropped the topic.
He has dropped the topic. It's fair to say. But again, he made the request, and there was no action in Congress, I would say. You know, there's not a lot of appetite for that kind of responsibility on Congress's part, in either party, frankly.
Yeah. Look, if Donald Trump can win this race, it's going to be as an outsider and a visceral strongman. And I was surprised at some of the words Hillary Clinton used last night. Reasonable, steady, diplomatic experience. But talking about summits and saying she'd agree to go to things, I was surprised at how tentative she was.
Right.
Now, maybe her view is she needs to say what she really feels. Maybe her view is that she needs to be reasonable and play to type and beat Trump, who's being a hotter
right.
figure. But again, I feel like if this continues, she will be under some pressure to be a little bit more black and white, a little bit less gray.
Can we take a moment, though, just to pause on the thing that President Obama was criticizing there in a fairly direct way, which was Newt Gingrich's comments last night, which were some of the most outrageous things I've heard a presidential candidate say in a long time. They're more outrageous than the things that Trump has proposed. They violated...
Outrageous that Gingrich walked it back a bit today.
Gingrich, but I mean, he started out last night basically saying anyone of Muslim belief should be rounded up, questioned. We should find out if they believe in Sharia law, and if they do, we have to deport them. I believe that violates at least three parts of the U.S. Constitution. And then he said that it should be a felony for us to look at websites that have information about Al-Qaeda or about ISIS on them. That would basically put most of the CIA and a fair number of journalists in jail, too. Insane.
Gingrich put on display why a lot of people, including me, thought putting him on the ticket risked having the running mate be the story more often than the top of the ticket.
Now, do you assume, I know the bell went off, but do you assume he was doing that because last night he saw he could still get on the ticket and he was trying to be like a tough guy and show Trump that he was like on his side?
I don't psychoanalyze Newt Gingrich.
Oh, that's a little weak. All right. The other big story in politics today is, of course, Donald Trump's announcement that Indiana Governor Mike Pence will indeed be his running mate. Just about everything about this entire process of deep stakes in Trump world has been unconventional. After delaying a planned unveiling of the news in Gotham City last night, ostensibly because of the Nice attack, at least he said that, the presumptive Republican nominee made his move official this morning in this tweet. A joint event with Trump and Pence is scheduled now for 11 a.m. tomorrow in Manhattan. But today, their logo was unveiled. That's kind of interesting. Wait a minute, guys, that I'm not sure that's, are we allowed to show that on TV? Let's fix that. Can we put up a safer work version? Okay, that's the safer work version. Thank you very much. Let's stick with that. I don't want to get in trouble with the censors. Anyway, in the meantime, Pence has been holed up at the old Intercontinental Hotel here in New York City, where he did take brief questions from reporters.
Governor Pence, do you have any comment?
Here's the car.
Governor Pence, how are you feeling right now?
What do you have to say to the people of Indiana today?
Very excited, very humbled, and very grateful.
What's your message to losers now that you've withdrawn from the governor's race?
We love Indiana. We love our country. My family and I couldn't be more honored.
What do you mean?
To have the opportunity to run with and serve with the next president of the United States.
Has Dan failed?
What wait that went on between the time that we thought that it was going to be you and Trump actually confirmed that it was you?
Governor, were you at all worried that Donald Trump was going to change his
Now, mind? Last night, in the middle of the night, on television, Donald Trump said, that was on Fox News, that he had still not made his final decision. Yet this morning, he apparently had. Something happened along the way. Mark, so here's my question. This has been an incredibly eventful 24 hours, certainly unlike anything I believe you or I have ever seen in a deep stakes process. Do you think that the way in which they handled this rollout has in any way harmed in a lasting way the pick?
No, the pick will rise or fall on its success, and I think it is, as we say in psycho, a falsity to say that Trump's endgame process was more chaotic either by their errors or just the way it played out as compared to others. I remember many, the selection of Sarah Palin that had more twists and turns. In this case, for the last 72 hours or so, people thought it would be Pence. It ended up being Pence. Now, there's some reporting that suggests Trump was thinking of changing his mind. We'll talk about it later in the show. But I think that nothing that happened at the end will matter. Pence will rise or fall on whether he turns out to be, over the next week or so, a good pick.
I agree with the last part. Everything else I disagree with. I think the entire thing was just a wild, uncontrolled goat rodeo of the highest caliber. You had the leaking of the Pence name, the reporting that Pence was the pick, then the walking back of the Pence name, then the cancellation of the event, now the scheduling of the event.
Get on Google and read about, remind yourself what happened with Sarah Palin, remind yourself what happened with Joe Lieberman.
I cannot believe that last night the man was saying, we cannot possibly have a press conference tomorrow out of respect for the people in Nice. And then this morning he's tweeting that he's made his pick earlier than the scheduled press conference. Like, that's the respectful way to treat tragedy.
Why would that have some impact on whether Mike Pence is a good pick?
Well, I said a minute ago, I agreed with you. I said, in the end, the pick will ride or fall on its substance. But I still don't think you can say, oh, this was just your average conventional rollout strategy. You think this is how they planned it?
No,
this kind of coverage was what they wanted?
Do you think the Palin pick was like that? Do you think the Lieberman pick was like that? You think the John Edwards pick was like that? The Dick Cheney one? All of them had media twists and turns that the campaign couldn't control.
Okay. Well, you know, I remember those picks. I think I do at least, and none of them seem quite as out of control as this one to me. Not a particularly, I think, well-managed roulette.
I'm going to get you Google for your birthday. Okay. When we come back, we're going to break down Donald Trump's VP pick more. What Mike Pence means to America after these words from our sponsors. Welcome back. The early returns are in on Donald Trump's new running mate. On the Republican side, the Club for Growth, Marco Rubio, Haley Barbour, and many others in the party have applauded the pick. House Speaker Paul Ryan tweeted he could think of, quote, no better choice for the slot than Pence. Many leading conservatives have been overjoyed that one of their own is joining the ticket. Other conservatives, though, are not as pleased. Ann Coulter called the decision Trump's, quote, first mistake. While Bob Vanderplatz of Iowa, a leading evangelical leader and a supporter of Ted Cruz and some other conservatives, looked at Pence's reversal on Indiana's religious freedom law last year and thought that suggested Cruz was not a conservative. They also don't like his decision to expand Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act. So, John, it's clear that the Trump campaign picked Pence in part to consolidate suspicious conservatives around the new ticket to help Trump. Hasn't worked with everybody, but is that goal on track? Will Pence, in the end, despite a few outliers, consolidate elite and grassroots conservatives for Trump?
I think that there's no doubt that there will be this will give some measure of aid and comfort. People like Paul Ryan are saying this is a good pick. To me, it's like there's some Republican leaders who want to see Trump's signs from Trump that he cares about conservative principles. They're willing themselves to want to believe he's actually a conservative. Pence goes some way towards doing that. There will be people who nitpick him from the right in the same way as there are going to be a lot of people who nitpick him from the left. But in the end, it'll move some measure towards doing that. But for people who still doubt Trump's real ideological convictions and bona fides, the second person on the ticket isn't going to solve that problem.
Yeah, I think it depends.
Whoever it is.
I think it depends a little bit on whether Pence is influential within the campaign.
Yeah.
You know, do they stress some of these conservative issues that Trump hasn't stressed? I also think we'll see how much grassroots work Pence does, reaching out to influential groups. I think if Pence spends time with groups, Trump has a good chance, unlike Romney and McCain to some extent, of consolidating conservatives if Pence really works it. And my indications are that he will, and that they have a notion of how to deploy him, not just in Cleveland, but beyond.
I think there's a chance of that. Again, though, I do think that I've been baffled by the way that that many people on the right have dealt with the Trump thing for a long time. You know, I'm still baffled by the fact that Paul Ryan can say, you know, he makes racist comments, he does this, he does that, but I'm still going to endorse him. And I understand some
of he may be racist, but he's our racist.
Right.
To paraphrase.
You know, yes. So, I think it helps to some extent, but again, the top of the ticket we both know matters more than anything else, right? And so, you know, if you have profound concerns about Trump as a conservative, does Pence solve that for you if you have profound concerns?
Well, there are a lot of conservative leaders who today made clear they like this pick.
They like the pick.
And they're people who had nothing good to say about Trump before.
So I agree.
Right away, they've converted some people. And I will also say, amongst conservative electeds, particularly in the House, where Pence is well known, this has meaning. Mike Pence is not just a standard issue conservative Republican who used to be in Congress and now is a governor. He is a leader in the conservative movement.
See, I have a larger question about it, though, which is the other side of the coin, which, you know, as your friend Joe Scarborough said immediately when he heard that Pence was going to be on the ticket, he said, you know, this is so off-brand. To me, it feels like a huge capitulation in some way to the Republican establishment, like just the whole idea of unity. We had Trump a couple months ago when Ryan called him out on some things saying, I don't care about Republican unity. The party should come with me or not, I'll go on my own. Now he's basically saying, well, I really need to unify the party at the convention. It seems very, to me, inconsistent with the kind of Trump, the strengths that Trump has exhibited in the past.
The pick of Pence to appeal not just to conservatives, but House members, donors, et
right.
cetera, shows that Trump went with his head, went with the advice that said, you need to do this to win. You can't go with the guys you like. You got to go with the guy who can help you win. And he did that.
Yeah, I just wonder, so for the people who love him for being an anti-establishmentarian, whether they'll like the pick, whether there's a cost side. Anyway, this is not breaking news. Donald Trump and Mike Pence do not see eye to eye on every policy issue. Now, there are always disagreements between presidential candidates, nominees and their VP picks, and people often overstate them. But let's go through a few of them in this instance. First of all, Mike Pence does not support Trump's Muslim ban. He called it, quote, offensive and unconstitutional in a tweet last year. They also differ on trade, on exceptions on abortion. and how same-sex marriage should be legislated. Trump says it's an issue for the states, and Pence wants a constitutional amendment banning gay marriage. Pence also expanded Medicaid in his state under the Affordable Care Act. A lot of commentators were discussing these differences today, and I wonder whether maybe White House Press Secretary Josh Earnest has any comments about Mike Pence.
You mean the TPP supporting Medicaid expanding Mike Pence?
That's what you want to call it.
No, I don't have any comment on it.
Well, that seemed like a comment to me. Anyway, Mark, of the disagreements we just laid out, which ones do you think could be actual potential problems?
Josh Earnest is going to end his run at the podium, I predict, engaging in comedy.
Yes.
Look, this is the Democrats are largely not challenging Pence's qualifications. They're basically saying he's extreme, and they've added another extremist to the ticket. There's also this attempt, as Josh did there, to sow discord between the running mates. You see this every time somebody gets picked. There's no two people who agree on everything. Some of their agreements are pretty profound. I think the one that's the toughest, and you see this in the talking points the campaign put out that our colleagues got on BloombergPolitics.com right now, the question of the Muslim ban, which Pence, as many Republicans did, denounced in no uncertain terms. They try to fuzz that up. I think Trump continues to move to the center on that, not all the way, but to the center more than the original proposal. I think that's the one that's the most dangerous. If Pence is asked about Trump's fundamental judgment on the original position, I think that's problematic. I don't see any of the others being a huge problem.
I do think that's conceivably a very large problem. I mean, he was very stark in terms of his condemnation of that proposal. And as we know, Trump has modified it in some ways. And there's now, apparently, according to our Bloomberg Politics colleagues, we have a story on the website about this. There's, you know, some kind of an internal memorandum that's out about how they're supposed to kind of walk their way through this, try to navigate some of these differences, especially on that issue. I think that's a problem. I think the trade thing is also kind of a problem. I mean, trade is so much at the core of Trump's economic message, and Pence is a bona fide, lifelong free trader.
As with Newt Gingrich, when he was trying to get the ticket,
he shifted a little bit. It would have been a problem for Gingrich, too.
I mean, you know, Trump says, I'm for free trade. I just want good trade. I want good deals. I'm not against all deals. I want good deals. I think Pence says, I'm for good deals, too. I trust Donald Trump to get in there and, unlike Barack Obama, negotiate good deals.
Dude, that is just word salad coming out of Donald
Trump.
Well,
it is, but...
If you're threatening a 25% export-import tariff on China, you're not a free trader. That's not what you are. Free trade means something, and you can say, I'm for free trade, but I want good deals, but you're not actually for free trade if you're going to implement those kinds of
tools. I agree
with
you in a rigorous, if this were being scored, like, you know, in a debate class. But in the rough and tumble of presidential politics, I just don't think any of these things are that hard to reconcile. They can fuzz over them. The press gets obsessed. Every time there's somebody on the ticket,
Pence was
the
for press NAFTA.
The press gets obsessed about these things. Look, almost anyone Trump could have picked would be for NAFTA.
Well,
you know? I mean, it's going to be a problem with anybody you put on the ticket.
Yes. Well, again, but it doesn't mean it's not a problem. I mean, our question is like whether we're going to be able to, whether you're going to have questions that are going to come up where people are going to say, hey, here's a relentless critic of NAFTA. Here's a guy who voted for it and was for it.
And he says, look at Trump's policies. Yeah. Look at what he says. He's going to get us good trade deals to help bring jobs back to America. I think except for the Muslim ban and even that, right. I think they'll finesse. I just don't see this as a big problem.
I know. If we let him off the hook on that, I think we're pretty weak.
Well, no, I agree. But it happens every 4 years. I mean, Joe Biden had disagreements with Barack Obama. Dick Cheney had disagreements with George Bush.
Yeah.
Just like the press obsesses about him, the other party tries to make hay, and then it all goes away. Usually by the convention, it all goes away.
Mainly because the vice presidents don't really matter that.
All right, up next, talk more about the Stop Trump movement and how it stopped in Cleveland right after this. Last night in Cleveland for members of the Rules Committee, the Republican National Committee, as part of a long, long, long list of potential rules changes, they debated whether or not delegates could be unbound from voting for Donald Trump at the convention next week. That was the last effort to try to stop Trump. That amendment and others offered up by the anti-Trump delegates failed to pass after members of the establishment on the committee and Trump supporters teamed up to keep the meeting in session late into the night. That move kind of had Fox the Never Trumpers, who had less time to figure out how to plan and whip the vote. The result was, of course, a relief for Trump campaign manager Paul Manafort, who did a bit of a victory lap on morning TV and on Twitter and said he was never all that worried that the Stop Trump movement would actually gain steam. After the vote, Utah Senator Mike Lee, a delegate on the Rules Committee who supported Ted Cruz during the nomination fight predicted there would be a backlash amongst delegates on the floor because the outcome did not free the delegates. John, was it politically smart for the RNC and Team Trump to engage in the kind of hardball tactics that Paul Manafort has learned well and basically squash the effort within the committee and not let there be a debate on the floor?
I don't see how it's not how it couldn't be smart. I know there's some argument to the notion that like how letting the never Trump people have their voice, that this will just by not letting them have it, this will alienate them in some permanent way. I just think like this was a threat to Trump's nomination. You got to squash it. You got to win the argument. You got to make him the nominee. That's the
they
end.
They played inside.
Win or lose.
They
win.
They played inside politics. They won. And right. I think the people who argue, most of the people who argue this were engaged in a little bit of trickery to basically say, oh, it's good for Donald Trump to let it be voted on the floor because then he can prove all the delegates love him. No, they were making mischief. I think if this had been gotten to the floor, even with a minority report and debated at all, the press would have focused on it. Maybe not the only thing, but a ton. Yeah. And this clears the decks for next week to be about what they want it to be about, which is attacking Hillary Clinton and saying Donald Trump can change America.
Look, those delegates who are never Trump, there's some high likelihood those delegates are never going to vote for Donald Trump. Nothing would have made them happy. Losing on the floor wouldn't have made them happier.
Yeah.
To me, this is highly theoretical. This is one place where I'm with the Trump campaign completely. It's like, you know, somebody who's trying to stop your guy from being the nominee. Crush them.
Yeah. And look,
crush them and move
they're
on.
They're feeling very good today, despite the horror of what happened in France. They're feeling good. They picked somebody. The rollout's going okay, despite the chaos of some of the end game. Pence is getting a pretty good reaction within the party. They had their victory in the Rules Committee. They're lining up speakers for the convention. You know, it's not an orthodox campaign.
No.
They know they're well behind schedule, but they're feeling pretty good about the last 24 hours of how the campaign's setting up. And the polls. Some of the polls, at least, look good for them.
But here's the other thing, right? The other thing is that there are a lot of things that could go wrong at this convention. A lot of things that could go wrong, even with this now put away.
Right.
You know, between the unconventional speakers list, between
protests,
all the stuff that could go haywire next week. Getting rid of one potential thing that could go haywire is good because it at least lets them now focus on the other things that could go haywire.
And we all know that distractions at conventions
right.
is something the press loves. Anything new and right. chaotic. Is stuff the press could cover. And this would have been hugely chaotic, even if it had just been the debate of a minority report that wasn't going
to
pass.
Get it out of the way before you have to deal with all the other things you have to deal with.
Yeah. All right. Ding.
Coming up. Well timed.
Man with the hat, our circus cohort, Mark McKinnon, joins us to talk more about the Trump and Clinton battle right after this. Joining us here now in the studio, Mark McKinnon, our fellow co-host, executive producer of The Circus, the Showtime documentary series, Sunday nights at 8 that we do in conjunction with Bloomberg Politics. Break the tie. I thought that Trump, the chaos was, you know, maybe in some ways more, in some ways less, but was this, as John believes, like a particularly chaotic endgame of deep stakes or not really?
I don't think so at all. I think when you kind of look
back. Tie broken, by the way. Go ahead. Keep going.
In fact, I'd say just the opposite of a tie. I think it was really imperative. If he's going to be the sort of, you know, the law and order candidate and make us safe from international threats, we got to know that he's got a pause button, you know, that it wasn't just all about him and his pick, that he realized that there were international events interceding. And so this showed that he has some impulse control, not only that he paused, but also I think because of the pick that he made in Mike Pence. I think, you know, we don't need another Captain Jack Sparrow. We need a Captain Phillips with him on the deck. So I think it sends the right signal to those. I mean, what he needed, as we've talked about, is A, somebody who people look at and say, this guy could step in and be president. But he's also a cool hand. He sends a good signal to the conservative base. And, you know, foreign policy experience, all those things. But so I think he brings the balance that was needed.
All right, so let me just put you in opposition to your old friend, Matthew Dowd, who was worked with you on two Bush campaigns. And Matthew Dowd's view was, why not go out there and do this event today, stand shoulder to shoulder with your running mate and announce that you were the team to fight terrorism? Why not do that?
Why not do that tomorrow? I mean, I disagree completely with that. I think you want to make sure. I mean, the criticism of Trump is that he jumps out and fires before he aims. In a situation like this, you want to step back, understand what's going on, and not overreact and come out and do what people don't want him to do, which is to look like he's going over the top, shooting too fast, that it's all about him. And that he, and by the way, a lot of people have seen that as saying, you know, he cares more about his VP pick than he does about what happened in the
and
France.
Let's deal with this reality. You know, at the time they made the decision,
yeah,
they didn't know all the facts. We still don't know all the facts. But it could have been, because I'm not saying they did it for news management reasons, but imagine if ISIS had put out a videotape saying, this is the first of several such attacks we're going to engage in. I don't care who he picked for his VP, it would have been overshadowed. And the Pence news was already a day old. So I think they partly waited to see, if we do it a day later, are we going to get a cleaner shot at telling
the
world?
By the way, just to testify the times we're living in, I remember at the beginning of this week when we were planning this week and thinking about all the things that might happen in the rollout of the VP, you said there could be a terrorist incident. And just thinking, geez, you know, now we're in a place where we think that this kind of thing could happen any week, all the time.
Right. To be clear, my position earlier was not that merely the delaying was the problem. It's just, it seems to me that this entire thing over the course of the last 24 hours has been uncontrolled. And now we have reports, we'll be talking to Kelly O'Donnell about this shortly, but we have reports that Trump was making phone calls last night at midnight trying to figure out if there was a way to get out of the pick. Yesterday, it seemed their press management was horrible. To me, again, watching the reporting on it, which was, it's Pence. Oh, no, wait, it might not be Pence. Wait, Trump may change his mind. Oh, now we have an event scheduled. No, now the event's being delayed. Now he's up in the middle of the night making phone calls, thinking about dumping Pence. I can't tell you that, like, reading the information flow on this pick has been like, this was a well-orchestrated, well-planned, button-down rollout. I just can't believe you're going to argue that.
I won't argue that, but I'll say I will argue that next week it won't matter.
Right.
It's just going to matter that he picked a guy and he made it through the next 48 hours.
So you look at Pence as a running mate over the next week. He's got to quickly prepare for this event tomorrow, give a speech at the convention, and do some press interviews, 60 Minutes, we're told, and others. Is Pence seem like a guy kind of off the shelf, can do all that stuff? Or,
well, that's the real test. We know, like Christie, we know that Christie could do that.
Yeah.
We knew that Newt could do that.
I don't know. I actually don't know that Newt could do it.
Well, he'd do it in his own style.
Yeah.
He would be confident and he'd absorb the heat. The question is, you know, it's a bigger stage. It's a hotter spotlight. How does he handle it? And that's a big role for the VP.
I was impressed with Pence today, right? Over at the Intercontinental, I was there. A bunch of reporters was there. Most people in that position, the campaign would, like, take out a secret entrance or they'd pretend they couldn't hear the reporters. He stopped and took questions. His answers were
brief.
Brief and also not
perfunctory.
Particularly compelling.
Yeah.
But he's not afraid of the
press. Well, that's important.
And he's got people around.
That is used to the
and
thrill.
He's got people around him now who are people who've been involved in national politics, and not everybody brings that to the table.
I think he's pretty solid.
Yeah. Do you think there's anything to the argument, again, another argument not voiced by me but by others, some people we think are really smart, that the picture's really off brand? That, you know, that either Gingrich or Christie would have been more of an on-brand pick, more, you know, more like Trump and not caring about the establishment, not caring about party unity, not caring about conservatives, just doing what he actually wants to do in his heart.
That's true, but that's not what you want in a VP. I mean, you want balance. I mean, we know that Newt is impulsive. We want to make sure that there's somebody there that's not impulsive in the White House. So, you know, I think for most voters, they look at that and they say, great, he brought a little balance, and I trust that there's somebody in there that will maybe, you know, hit the pause button when he doesn't.
Yeah. Do no harm, be boring. That's good for Trump. That's good for Trump at this point.
Exactly.
No, I'm not being facetious.
No,
I mean,
I know.
But that's a positive for him in this
instance. So how does Pence fall short of the perfect pick?
Well, maybe not the attack dog that you sometimes imagine in a vice president. I mean, I think he had a confrontation with Obama once, didn't handle it that well.
Yeah.
You know,
although his brief speech the other night in Indiana that I was at when he did the joint appearance with Trump, I thought he was pretty good as an attack dog.
Yeah, no, I think he's evolved and I think he's grown, and we will see. But I mean, that's
or
not
any other way he falls short of if you could Franken candidate him and say, want more of this, more of that?
I don't think so. I mean, the one thing that's happening, and it happens every time, it happened with Cheney when President Bush picked Cheney, you know, they're going to hang all the ideological stuff off him and go after that. But the one thing I've learned through this process is the voters really don't care about that stuff. They just care about, you know, where the top of the ticket is ideologically.
Right. And you think there's no question that he's going to clear very quickly with the press, the ready to be commander in chief.
I do.
That's not going to be a problem for him.
I've not seen anybody go after
him. No, I agree with you about that so far. I'm just seeing if you think there's any potholes for him down the road on that.
Not that I've sensed, and not that I see.
It is just such a Groundhog Day thing. Like, every 4 years, there's all this speculation about different traits and different things, regional balance, age, you know, all this stuff. And then in the end, to me, it continues, this proves it binary. Does it clear the bar, ready to be commander-in-chief or not? I'm looking now. Is anybody out there planned to go after Pence and say he's not ready to be president? Call now, 800, with all due respect. I just think if you can't get the person on that, they're gonna be fine. All this ideological differences and all that stuff.
Good demeanor, good Midwestern kind of, you know, calm, steady. In central casting, he looks like a vice president. He looks good.
Really? I don't know this, but you know, there was a look for a vice president.
Sure there is.
MCAT.
Gray hair.
Look at you.
Look at you.
Mark McKinnon, thank you. Up next, Scoop Meister, NBC correspondent Kelly O'Donnell shares with us the story she reported earlier today about Donald Trump allegedly having some second thoughts after offering the job to Mike Pence. We'll talk to her about that right after this.
Joining us now, Bloomberg Politics super stud reporter Mike Bender. Michael C. Bender, let's be clear about that. And out in Cleveland, NBC News correspondent Kelly O'Donnell, who had quite the tweet today about what Donald Trump was up to late last night. We'll get to Kelly momentarily, but Mike, So again, I'm going to try to get back to a tie, okay, because I got shut down by McKinnon. I have my own views. How do you think this rollout for vice president has gone for Donald Trump?
How the rollout has gone?
Yeah, how's it gone?
What rollout? I mean, there hasn't been a rollout yet, right? I mean, this isn't going to happen until tomorrow at 11 o'clock, John. I can't imagine. This has got to be some of the toughest 24-hour stretch in for Trump in the last few months here. This is not how he wanted to do it. I think he probably did want to tweet it and probably wanted to tweet it for a while. But, you know, this delay is not ideal for him by any stretch.
Kelly O'Donnell, let's ask you, let's just get right to the heart of the story here. Last night, Donald Trump, according to you, sources speaking to you, maybe trying to get out of the Pence pick. Tell us what you know.
Well, we have been reporting that Donald Trump was frustrated watching the coverage unfold during the day, that the leaks had gotten out. And we know that it has been a difficult choice for him because there were differing views within his family, within the inner circle, different voices coming at him from the party about what he should do, especially with the top three finalists. And they, of course, are Mike Pence, Newt Gingrich, and Chris Christie. And so I have been told by multiple sources that he was on the phone, which we know is a Trump trademark. He likes to solicit a lot of opinions. He likes to talk to a lot of people. And he was expressing some angst, some concern about being backed into a corner on his VP pick and wondering if there was a way out. At the same time, I've talked to sources who say he expressed some of that angst, but knew and did not plan to make a change. Now, the Trump campaign today flatly denies that there were any calls, any wavering, any attempt to change it. And they do acknowledge there were calls between Trump and the office about postponing the rollout. And they say that was only about the events in Nice, France, not anything else. Now, we all know that when VP picks happen, there is an inordinate amount of stress involved. There are relationships here where you've got Newt Gingrich and Chris Christie, who have long-term relationships with Trump, have been publicly and privately supportive of him for a long time. And then you have Mike Pence, newer to this whole thing, had not endorsed Trump in the beginning, did so after he won Indiana. And many in the party think he's the ideal choice because of his skill set. But he is not as well known to Trump. And so this was never about not liking Mike Pence or having any doubts about him as a good choice. It was about comfort level, about wishing he could pick Christie or wanting to be able to go with his gut and finding that the circumstances were just not going to let him do that. So what we know about Trump is that he does like to talk, and sources are saying in those conversations he was sort of airing that anxiety about not being able to do what his heart told him, feeling like he was compelled to do the politically expedient and professionally advised thing of picking a more conservative, traditional Republican.
So Mike,
wait for the book on this one.
In the run-up to the convention, you got to pick your running mate. That's done. You got to put out a speaker's list. That's, you know, done, but I think it's a little bit in flux. And you got to deal with platform fights and things like that. That seems to be straightened out. So my question is the Trump acceptance speech, less than a week away. Yeah. What do we know anything about? Is it somebody writing one? Is he going to practice, which is what a normal nominee would do?
Well, I know there's...
from...
Oops.
That's good. Mike first,
oh, go
and then
ahead,
Kelly.
there's nothing normal about this campaign so far, right? Yeah. I mean, the speech is being worked on by the same folks who are doing the speech, who have been doing his speeches, and the practice so far has been the handful of teleprompter speeches that Trump has given, which has been an improvement. In the campaign that led up to this last couple of months, I don't think we can expect anything normal, and I wouldn't. I would set the bar at sort of the speeches he's given so far, and if he can exceed that, that's going to be a victory for Trump.
Kelly.
I was just going to say that I have been told that there has been a lot of talk about the speeches, passing some speeches around from Trump, his family, wanting to get the best ideas and go over it. Obviously, very high bar for everyone in the family that will be speaking. Trump, of course, with the big acceptance speech, but also other members of his family who we haven't seen in this way before. Melania Trump, not a big fixture on the campaign trail, but will be present here at the convention. So work is going on, and some of this is new territory for them.
Yeah, if you look at the last three Republican nominees who lost, yeah. Dole, McCain, and Romney, yeah. They kind of underperformed in their acceptance speeches.
Kind of, yeah, a lot, right?
Bush, lot. I think both of his acceptance speeches were pretty good. Yeah. So if past his prologue, Trump needs to give a great speech.
You know, the funny thing about Trump, though, is that there's such a balance with him between the fact that the things he gives, the moments that are most memorable are the least scripted.
Exactly.
And the ones when he's most scripted is when he's, like, actually the least Trumpy. So yeah. There's going to be a tension there. What do you think is the biggest thing that could go wrong, Mike Bender? Like, what's the, like, now that the never Trump thing's been put down, and now that this pick is, we'll get Trump, Pence tomorrow, there'll be all the normal reaction, but we roll in. What's the biggest thing that they have to worry about now?
Well, staying on message. I mean, and when it comes to the speech, how well he can stay on message, and his eagerness to grab headlines by being outrageous. If he can keep that, you know, wrapped up, I think that's the biggest, you know, the biggest challenge for him right now.
Kelly, what's your sense of how the Pence pick is playing, at least within the Republican Party?
I think there is exactly what Paul Manafort and the team wanted, a sigh of relief, a sense of reassurance, a predictability in Mike Pence because of his service on Capitol Hill, work in the governor's mansion, as well as his real relationships with social conservatives, with certain key donor groups. There is a sense that he is that kind of do-no-harm candidate. Might not be as exciting or as kind of feisty as other options might have been, might not be someone who would wage the war as effectively down the line, but a real sense that this is Trump looking like a serious candidate. And that is really the early feedback, and that should put Trump's mind more at ease if he's trying to win over the party. The hard part was this is really kind of a pick that steps away from the Trump brand, may add to it, but that's, I think, where some of the discomfort has been.
Let me ask you this question, Mike Bender. It is real quick. Do you think they're going to campaign together a lot? I mean, it's not necessary, right? Barack Obama and Joe Biden hardly ever campaigned together in the fall of 2008, and that was quite successful. Will these guys be out there together a lot or basically never see each other after next Thursday?
It's hard for me to imagine Trump wanting to campaign with Pence that much. They're going to go out initially. They're talking about some spots maybe in the Midwest right after the announcement and then splitting up. Pence, like, I mean, Kelly mentioned the sort of off-brand. Pence is so buttoned up and that I just can't see how him and Trump can play off each other at the same event.
All right, Mike Bender, Kelly O'Donnell, love having both of you, especially when one of you brings news. Bender, that's a shot at you. Coming up, a city, a convention, and the great Will Leach. And if you happen to be watching us in Washington, D.C., you can also listen to us on the radio at Bloomberg 99.1 FM. We'll be right back.
Next week, Cleveland becomes the center of the political solar system, and the timing for the city could not be better. Cleveland, of course, coming off a buoyant NBA season, which for those of you who don't follow sports is a pretty big deal. In fact, Cleveland is catching a wave of good fortune in the world of sport ball right now. As our culture and politics maestro Will Leach will tell you, that could be just what the Republican Party needs next week.
Sports in Cleveland has long existed solely to make Clevelanders unhappy. It's a vague, unceasing unhappiness, like a dull ache that never goes away. One fan's recent obit summed it up this way. He respectfully requests 6 Cleveland Brown pallbearers so the Browns can let him down one last time. Generations of Clevelanders have always understood the deal. That is, until now. With LeBron James' Cleveland Cavaliers stunning the world, Cleveland already feels different. The Indians are in first place. The Browns have new management, including the guy Jonah Hill played in Moneyball. Somehow, the sun is shining in Ohio. Enter the Republicans. When Cleveland was selected as the RNC convention site, it was with hope for Rust Belt poignancy, a city of economic pain and manufacturing decline, fighting to come back. A fitting stage for a Republican Party trying to resurrect itself. Make Cleveland great again, you know, that sort of thing. But out of nowhere, Cleveland broke character, turning into the giddiest town in America, celebrating so hard that the president had to remind star Cavaliers guard J.R. Smith to put his shirt back on.
Tell J.R. and everybody to put on a shirt, though.
The point is that Republicans are arriving to a profoundly different place. Certainly the city is bracing for conflict and protest over Trump, but that backdrop we're so accustomed to, a post-apocalyptic cityscape resembling Cormac McCarthy's The Road, has given way to a sports-infused Neverland of champions.
So, will the GOP adapt to its new surroundings? Will the RNC tweak the script? Will LeBron be invited on stage? Whether or not you are better off than you were 8 years ago is up for debate. But suddenly, we know one thing for certain. Cleveland sure is.
Many thanks to Will Leach, and we'll be right back. Two weeks ago, we had our friend Mike Elliott, the CEO of the One Campaign and the former editor of both Time International and Newsweek International, as a guest here on the show. Mike has been had been battling cancer bravely and uncomplainingly for 2 years. Last night, he passed away in Washington at the age of 65. As a journalist, Mike had an unquenchable curiosity about the world, and he also had an unmatched dexterity at explaining everything to his readers.
In the last stage of his career at One, Mike dedicated himself to the cause of ending extreme poverty and disease in the developing world. As a husband, father, and friend, he was a man of uncommon integrity, infectious good humor, and otherworldly generosity with his time, advice, his stories, and his spirit. I know you knew Mike from your time working at Time. What are you going to remember?
Loved working with him. He's a great journalist, and he did the two things that I always tell people journalism is about. He held powerful interests accountable to the public interest, and he loved great stories with great characters.
Yeah. I met him in 1990 when I really was just first starting the business. First guy really ever gave me a job, and a lot of the things that I think are what journalism's all about, I learned from Mike, and his curiosity really was boundless. He was interested in absolutely everything, and you could talk about anything, wanted to know about everything, and was always incredibly interested. And there were so many young journalists who he took under his wing and brought them into the world and into the world of journalism and made them better.
And if you were in the room with him and a great story came up, he got a gleam in his eye. Loved a great story like all great journalists.
Raconteur of all raconteurs, all right. Our thoughts and our prayers go out to Mike's beloved wife, Emma, and his incredible daughters, Roxana and Gina. Remembering him this morning, Mike's last boss, Bono, said, quote, above all else, he wanted his life to be useful, and it was definitely that, but a whole lot more.
All right, Kevin Cirilli and Jennifer Jacobs, our colleagues, have a scoop now on BloombergPolitics.com about the Trump campaign's strategy to sell Mike Pence to the public. Check that out. Coming up here on Bloomberg TV, the latest news from the ongoing situation in Turkey. We'll see you Monday from Cleveland. Thanks for watching. Sayonara.